Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon. Thank you so much, Professor Kutayba, for this an advanced really presentation. And our next speaker is Dr. Hassan Al-Dhikri. Dr. Hassan Al-Dhikri, he had his Saudi board in 2000, and he finished his fellowship in allergy clinical immunology here in King Faisal in 2000. Had another fellowship in allergy and clinical immunology in McMaster in Canada in 2004. He will present today food allergy between truth and fictions. So he has 20 minutes to present.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah. Good afternoon, everybody. I want to welcome all of our audience, speaker, moderator in our symposium. And I hope everybody had a good lunch from the boxes. I know it is somebody is not happy, but anyway, my talk is about food allergy. Food allergy, it's a major public problem. It has been increasing in prevalence in the last decades. I will start with some definition. First reaction to food is a clinical abnormal response to food after ingestion, and it could happen after inhalations or contact. We divide it into this adverse reaction in two parts. If it's immune-mediated, we call it allergy. If it's non-immunological in nature, we call it food intolerance. Food intolerance, it's account for the majority of the adverse food reaction. Non-immunological or the food intolerance, we have example for that, which is toxic or pharmacological, which is substance-related. It's like bacterial food poisoning, like caffeine and histamine, heavy metal poisoning. Non-toxic, like lactase deficiency, galactosemia, pancreatic insufficiency. For the food allergy or the immunological in nature, we divide it into three parts: IgE-mediated, like oral allergy syndrome, anaphylaxis, urticaria. We have a cell-mediated, like protein-induced enterocolitis, protein-induced enteropathy, and we have combined IgE as well as cell-mediated, like eosinophilic esophagitis and eosinophilic gastritis and atopic dermatitis. Prevalence of the food allergy. The perception in the public, it's about 20 to 25. But when it is confirmed by oral challenge, we left with only 2 to 6 in pediatric and 1 to 2% in adult. It is the greatest in the first few years of life and 80% present in infancy or the first year of life. The prevalence in specific disorder. Food allergy is responsible for almost half of the cases of anaphylaxis, one-third of atopic dermatitis, and about 20% or one-fifth in urticaria cases. Asthma, it's attributed to food allergy in only 5 to 6%. Oral allergy syndrome, it contributes good percentage, which is about 25 to 75 in pollen allergic patient. Luckily, we have certain food, which is about 8 items, which is responsible for more than 90% of allergy, food allergy or allergic disease. And we have it in the pediatric age group, milk, egg, and peanut, as well as soya bean and wheat. And in adult, we have peanut, tree nut, fish, and shellfish. And the dietary habit, this is may, and the method of presentation may play a role as we have a difference in prevalence as in the state, more in the peanut, whereas in China, it is less prevalence of peanut, and this is because it's roasted in the state and it is boiled in China. This table, it will show the prevalence in the pediatric as well as the adult, and as we can see here, the milk is number one in the pediatric, and in the adult, it's the shellfish, and then followed by the peanut and the tree nut. The pathophysiology or the mechanism behind the food allergy, the exact one, it is not clear, and it is not known, and there is many hypotheses behind it. But the conclusion from that is the food allergy, this is developed in a genetically predisposed individual when oral tolerance failed to develop normally or when it is a breakdown. And what happened in the IgE-mediated type, whenever the patient is exposed or sensitized, the protein is digested, and there will be antigen processing and the presentation to the T cell, and then more the T cell, it will direct the B cell to produce more IgE. And whenever there is a second exposure, what will happen is there will be amassed, the IgE, it will combine to the antigen, and there will be a mast cell degranulation and release of histamine and other mediator. This sensitization of food allergy can occur in two ways. The traditional way, which is in the gut, or as a consequence of allergic sensitization, which is having inhalant allergen, which we call it as a class 2. I will touch on a few disorder, starting with oral allergy syndrome, which is elicited by a plant protein that cross-react with airborne allergen, as ragweed, birch, and mugwort. And we have example for that for the grass. This is the patient will have symptoms whenever he eat tomato or melon or orange. For ragweed allergic patient, we have symptoms secondary to melon, banana, and cucumber. It is easily broken down by heat or gastric enzymes. That means most of the patient, they will have it in the oral and the pharyngeal mucosa, and they can tolerate it when it is exposed to heating or when it is boiled. Latex-free syndrome, we have 30 to 50% of those with latex allergy are sensitive to some fruit, and due to cross-reactivity of IgE, most common fruit like banana, avocado, kiwi, and chestnut. Allergic eosinophilic esophagitis and gastroenteritis, it is characterized by infiltration of esophagus and stomach and or part of the intestinal wall with eosinophil. It is associated with 50% of peripheral eosinophilia, and in the histopathology there will be absence of vasculitis, basal zone, hyperplasia, papillary elongation, as well as the presence of eosinophil more than about 20, which is in most of the study it has been ranging between 15 to 24 half high power field. Allergic eosinophilic esophagitis present as gastroesophageal reflux. It is seen in infancy and adolescent, but it is more diagnosed in adult because of more endoscopy and more biopsy is done. Some patient report seasonal symptoms. Allergic eosinophilic esophagitis might present as a stomach outlet obstruction with weight loss and failure to thrive. And this slide, it will tell us, this is the histopathology. As we can see it in B, this is the normal one. Whereas in D, this is the predominant eosinophil, which is more than 20 by high power field. Food allergy is a risk factor for life-threatening asthma, and in this study, about half of asthmatic children requiring intubation for severe asthma had a food allergy compared to only 10% for the placebo group. Fiber or steam containing a protein which is emitted from cooking food, like fish, can induce asthmatic reaction and even cause anaphylaxis. Food allergy is a major cause of anaphylaxis, as I mentioned, one-third to about one-half of anaphylaxis seen in the EMS, and the major allergen which is causing this is a peanut and part of the tree nut. This is a study which is done. We have 32 fatal food-induced anaphylaxis. Most were adolescent or young adult, a previous history of reacting to the implicated food. Virtually all had asthma. And we have peanut or tree nut were responsible for the 94% of the cases. Food-associated exercise-induced anaphylaxis. This is occur only when the patient eats specific food after exercise within 2 to 4 hours of exercise. It contributed about half of the cases of exercise-induced anaphylaxis caused by food allergy. It's most common in the female age group, 15 to 35. And this is the distribution of anaphylaxis caused by different food items, 20% by the peanut and legumes group, and 14% it is the other tree nut. This is a question which is we are frequently asked, is can the patient outgrow the food allergy? The answer for that is yes or no. Yes for some food allergens and no for the other. For the peanut, we have in this study as well as the other study, it showed that there is a good percentage of patients, which is about 20%, they outgrow. Because we had in the belief in the past that peanut allergy as well as fish and the shellfish, it will be permanent. But in this study, as well as the other study, to confirm that about 20% of the cases, they outgrow of this allergy. Cow milk allergy as well as egg allergy, this is a prospective study for the milk allergy, and it found that 50% outgrown in the first year, and 70 in the second year, and 85 by age of 3. Diagnosis of the food allergy. As the other disease in medicine, we start with history, and in the history, we have to concentrate on a specific point, and this is including the onset of the symptoms in minutes to hours, what type of food and how it's served, and the quantity of the food. The symptom which is developed, is it rapid? Is it, we are trying to assess if it's an IG mediated or non-IG mediated, if there is any associated event like exercise or the ingestion of aspirin or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications. And then we go for physical examination, looking for any signs of atopy, which will make the incidence of food allergies higher. And then we proceed for some investigation, and this is including skin testing. And the skin test, it's rapid method for it's only, we have the result in 20 minutes, and we could do it in the forearm. And this is the positive skin test in some of the patient, and we could do it in the back in case of pediatric age group less than 5. And we have 3 millimeter more than the negative control, we call it positive. For a fruit and vegetables, commercial extract, sometimes we have a false negative result, so we need to do a brick method. Batch test, there's been a study using the batch test for the diagnosis of the food allergy, and it's usually for identifying the non-IgE type, but it is not a standardized reagent is being used. It's causing non-specific irritation and need a skilled person, so it's not clinically recommended to use it so far until we have a further study. RAST, which is a quantitative measurement of the food-specific IgE, and when the RAST exceeding a certain value, it will make it more than 95% likely to react to oral challenge, as I will show you the number. If the patient has less than 0.35, that means still the patient, it could be positive skin test, can still have a positive reaction. This is the certain value, which whenever we have it, that means the patient more likely to react. For the milk, we have the value is 15 if he's more than 2 years, and 5 for less than 2 years of age. For the egg, it is 7 and 2. For the peanut, it is 14. For the fish, it's 20, and so on. Allergenic epitope of many major food allergens were mapped. And this is what I mean by epitope. It is the antibody which is combined specifically to part of the antigen. This is determined specifically where the patient IgE bind to these protein. Conformational and sequential epitope. What I mean by for sequential and conformational epitope, as we can see here, I do not have a pointer, but this one, this is the whenever this is the epitope of that. This is the conformational. So when it is heated or when there is a change, that there will be diffusion of the antigen or the epitope to different part. But the sequential epitope is whenever the allergens or the antigen it is hydrolyzed, it will not change, it will stay the same. So individual hoposis IgE, it is sequential epitope, react to food in any form, whereas IgE to conformational epitope, tolerate a small amount after heating or hydrolysis. Patient with egg and milk allergy, IgE directed to sequential epitope tend to have a persistent allergy, and IgE antibody primarily to conformational epitope tend to have clinical tolerance. The number of epitope is very important, where we have many epitope that mean more severe reaction compared to few epitope. The presence of IgE antibody to distinct allergenic epitope of cow milk patient can be used as a marker of persistent cow milk allergy. And in this study, they have compared the patient with persistent cow milk and compared to the placebo, which is outgrown their cow milk allergy. And they found six major cow milk allergy, which is including casein and lactoalbumin and lactoglobulin. Determination of food-specific IgE level over time can predict the development of tolerance in the cow milk and egg allergy. And in this study by Sheikh and his group, as you can see here in the table, is the decrease in the specific IgE over 1 year. And if we have a reduction in 50% reduction, that's mean there is a 0.52 probability of the patient to outgrow. And the higher is the reduction, is the higher the probability the patient will lose his allergy. And it is more in the cow milk, in the egg allergy compared to the milk allergy. It will aid the clinician in providing a prognostic and the timing of the food challenge and decrease the number of premature and unnecessarily double-blind placebo-controlled food challenge. The clinical implication of the cross-reactivity of food allergy, we need to have at least 70% and more of identity in the primary sequence for the cross-reactivity. And if we have this, some of the patients will ask us, if I am a peanut allergic, am I allowed to eat other lentils and other legumes? The answer is for this table. We need to be concerned, and we need to have we need to alarm the patient in case if he's allergic to fish and the shellfish, where we have the cross reactivity. As you can see here, for the shellfish, it is high, it is 75, and 50% in case of fish. And in for the cow milk compared to the goat milk, we have heights about 92. Oral food challenge, it is still a double-blind placebo-controlled food challenge, remain the gold standard for the diagnosis. Open challenge, open or single-blind are often used for screening of food unlikely to provoke reaction. Suspected food should be eliminated for about 1 to 2 weeks. And the most important of this is the low blood pressure occur in 15% of patients. So we have to do it in an equipped, well-equipped place. Therapy of the food allergy, it's including educations of the patient. It includes elimination and medical alert, early epinephrine use, and the prompt medical care. And as we can see here in this, this is the EpiPen, which is used for life-threatening reaction. Elimination remains the only approved therapy so far. And education, it's very important in educating the patient regarding the symptoms of the food allergy, regarding how to recognize after accidental exposure the reaction as well as the severe reaction, and how to read the labels and how to avoid the high risk situation like open buffet. And as we can see here, this ice cream, it contains peanut, tree nut, cow milk, egg, and wheat. So it contains everything for a patient who's allergic. Immune therapy, I will touch a few points about this. Subcutaneous immune therapy for a peanut was the first to investigate desensitization for food allergy in a placebo control. But the frequency of the adverse reaction was unacceptably high. What's about oral immune therapy and SLIT? Many study in the last couple of years, it showed the oral immune therapy for the food allergy as well as the SLIT. And one of these study, I will mention it, is about the specific oral tolerance induction in a children with very severe cow milk allergy. They are trying to induce the tolerance for the patient. We have 97 were recruited, and only 60 patients they have included in the study. And they are all of them, they have a very high RAST, more than 80. And they divided into two groups. or for 1 year of time, and the result of this after 1 year, about 36, which is 11 patients out of the 30 control of the active group, they tolerated a limited amount, whereas 54% they tolerated between 5 to 150, which mean in case of accidental exposure, we have the patient is tolerating and he is not developing symptoms. Oral and sublingual immune therapy study, all of this have all provided encouraging result on the milk, egg, peanut, hazelnut allergy, but still remain major question and concern, and this is including the safety, long-term tolerance versus transient desensitizations. Chinese herbal medicine, FAHF, this has been tried in a murine model with a peanut anaphylaxis and completely protect the mice during the peanut challenge and reduce the peanut-specific IgE and Th2 responsiveness. This is another recent study, which is, again, about the use of this Chinese herbal medicine, and it showed a single course of FAHF2 treatment completely protected from anaphylaxis for more than 6 months, which is about post-treatment, which is about 25% of the mouse lifespan. And thank you a lot. Okay.